Have you been to the Biennale di Venezia this year? There are some pretty amazing art installations in this year's Biennale. Stay tuned and I will show you the highlights of the 59th edition of the Biennale Arte. Coming up next.
Buongiorno, this is Ken and welcome to my channel, Ken Travel 360. So we are now on the Vaporetto to get to Giardini for the Biennale. So we're here now for the 2022 Biennale di Venezia, the art edition. This year, the exhibition was curated by Cecilia Alemani, and this year we have the title, The Milk of Dreams. Okay, let's go in. So normally the odd years are for art and even years are for architecture, but due to the pandemic, it didn't happen in 2020. So we have the art edition this year in 2022. Remember that you must buy a ticket beforehand online. Right, we're about to enter now.
Goodbye, thank you too.
Benvenuto alla Biennale. Each country that is participating has their own pavilion. Some of the smaller ones may not have a permanent one. On the Giardini Central's pavilion facade, we find plastic sharks and fish adorned with a surfboard, electric guitars, ukuleles, sarongs, and stuffed gingham pattern missile. So the curator Cecilia Alemani has decided to open the exhibition with some really big show pieces.
This piece, Elephant, was created by Katharina Thrish. The significance of the elephant is that as a matriarchal animal, it's an emblem of a biennale dominated by women artists. If her name sounds a bit familiar to those who live in London, it's because she was the one who created the Han Kok sculpture that was put on the fourth plinth in Trafalgar Square in 2013. We're gonna walk through the central pavilions to show you some of the highlights.
This is the Estonia Pavilion. Let's go check it out. This sculpture resembles a printer that is constantly printing something. So behind me is the Belgium Pavilion. The title of the exhibition is The Nature of the Game by Francis Alice. The whoops, howls, chatter and laughter of unruly children are not normally welcome in art exhibitions, but here they take center stage, filling the Belgian pavilion with a joyful cacophony. The sounds accompany a playground of screens showing a selection of short films of children's games made by Belgian-born Mexican-based artist Francis Alice. Among them are snippets of competitive snail racing in Belgium, kites flying in Afghanistan, mimicking mosquito in the Democratic Republic of the Congo, and pandemic-era tech in Mexico, where one viral child in a red mask gradually catches and contaminates all the rest.
The Danish pavilion has some disturbing images. A male centaur hangs from the ceiling by a noose, and the female counterpart lies in a farmhouse stall, impassive in the act of giving birth.
Looks like the Russian pavilion is shut this year. So we are now inside the Nordic pavilion. And this year, the Nordic pavilion is the Sami pavilion. Flooded with lateral light and centered by three trees going through the roof, the architecture of the Nordic pavilion subtly resonates with the theme of land dispossession and guardianship that underpin the complex works of the three artists this year. Visitors may be struck first and most viscerally by the olfactory elements of Sarah's suspended sculpture, which takes the bodies of reindeer's calves as both the subject and material.
These hanging pieces of reindeer calves actually smell. According to the description, one has the smell of fear and the other has the smell of hope. These collage paintings were created by Anders Sunner.
Together, they depict his family's 50 years saga of court battles to defend their reindeer herding livelihood against the Swedish authorities. So right now I'm in Korea Pavilion. The title is Giri by Yoon Chun Kim. Kim studied music, and it is music above all that lies at the heart of his practice. All his structure, he explained, are time-based and events-based. They're also fluid and dancing. This transdisciplinary approach is dramatically embodied in the giant installation in Coma 5, which resemble a dinosaur skeleton, but is entirely generated by algorithms. This is the spectacular swollen suns, which detect and respond to cosmic particles as they collide with our planet's atmosphere. So this is a German pavilion. In her project Relocating a Structure, German Pavilion 2022, Maria Eckhorn tackles the eventful history of the German pavilions since the beginnings of the Biennale. At the outset of the project, Eckhorn developed the idea of relocating the German pavilion for the duration of the Biennale and then faithfully reassembling it on its original site. With this as a starting point, the artist has foundation excavated and layers of plaster removed to reveal the joints between the different sections of the pavilion, which consists of essentially two buildings: the Bavarian Pavilion built in 1909 and the extension built by the Nazis in 1938. The hidden original building could thus be revealed. So this is Great Britain's Pavilion. This year, the British Commission is by Sonia Boyce, Feeling Her Way. So we are now in the French pavilions. And the title is Dreams Had No Titles by Zineb Zadira. Stepping into the French pavilion is like venturing onto a film set, which is exactly what happens when you experience the Biennale presentation of Zineb Zadira. The French-Algerian artist focused on Algerian cinema of the 1960s and 70s and its links to the Italian and French film industries. The subject matter is timely as 2022 is the 60th anniversary of Algeria achieving independence from France. On 5th of July 1962, Algeria became a sovereign state after an 8-year war that resulted in the deaths of at least 400,000 Algerians. If you enjoyed this video, please give me a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe to my channel with notifications on. This way, you will always be notified when I release a new video. This is Swatch, the description of the world. In front of us is the Piazza Ucrania. It's a place of solidarity with Ukraine in the very heart of the international exhibition. Simone Lee has transformed the US pavilion with her facade installation that runs a thatch skirt and wooden columns around the building. It covers the classical architecture that is reminiscent of Thomas Jefferson Monticello's plantation, where more than 400 enslaved people once lived and worked during his lifetime. This is a pavilion reclaimed by the first black female artist to represent the US, and Lee's 7-meter-tall bronze sculpture based on dimber headdresses in the shape of a female bust towers over visitors as they arrive. Lee's work explored the black female body and imagery from the African diaspora. So let's enter Brazil's pavilion. Looks like a year or something like that, the entrance. So it turns out we did step in for a year, and the exit would be stepping for another year apparently. Here you have a head swinging around. So we exit for another year. This one is Romania Pavilion. Out on the periphery of the Giardini, it will be easy to skip the Romania Pavilion.
But if you arrive here on the hour when the 45-minute video installation begins, then you'll be rewarded with a profound, if deeply uncomfortable, experience. In one room, the night channel work is shown on an enormous screen, while a smaller installation next door shows more videos, reflected onto mirrors and held onto a sculptural robotic arm that is an enlarged version of the equipment used to do the filming. The videos are incredibly explicit. The woven narratives bring together individuals who all appear naked and tackle issues of the body, sexuality, and intimacy through talking, dancing, or touching. The Venice Pavilion. Everything changes, nothing dies, everything flows, and every image is formed in movement.
So we've finished with the Giardini part of the Biennale. Tomorrow, we'll go to the other half of the Biennale at Arsenale.
Buongiorno. It's Sunday today, and we are going to the Biennale again. We're on the Rapporetto 5.2, just crossing under the bridge. It's 10 o'clock on Sunday. We're heading to Arsenale now for the Biennale di Venezia. So this is the entrance for the Biennale di Venezia, Arsenale side. So the Arsenale side of the Biennale is open with this great piece from Simon Lee. It's called Brick House. Simon Lee is of course the same artist who is responsible for the exhibition in the American Pavilion this year. This sculpture was first displayed in New York in 2019. As the opening piece, this sculpture makes a really dramatic statement. Here, in the next hall, we have some very impressive stuff. This is Gabriel Childs. For the Milk of Dreams, Charlie presents a group of five sculpture ovens that portray, in a large format, members of his family. This is Nikki de Saint-Val's Gwendoline. When I saw it from a distance, I thought it looks like Nikki de Saint-Val's, and it is.
You may notice Gwendoline is pregnant, if not from her wide, sinuous curves, then from the bullseye painted on her stomach. Towering over 2.5 meters tall, Gwendoline is one of the Saint-Val's first monumental nunnas.
The work here is called Earth Paradise, in which the soil raises above the ground and is surrounding the spectators' bodies. This black and white series of painting depicts sinuous creatures and insects that are in the act of metamorphosis. The next session of the exhibition is called The Seduction of the Cyborg. So the three pieces of work in front is by Teresa Solar. Solar's new series, Tunnel Boring Machine, comprised of three large sculptures inspired by animals and prehistoric life forms, reminiscent of fish gills, dolphin fins, beaks, blades, and oars. Treated with a high polished finish, these works speak to a conception of abstracted time. They're inventions of fictions and simulation, composition of a long, hidden, earthly skin.
Korean artist Mira Lee makes kinetic sculptures that suggest the tension of states of aliveness, often composed of low-tech motors, steel rods, and PVC hoses filled with grease, silicon, and oil. These animatronic apparatuses at once resemble machines and internal organs.
To me, this sculpture looks like an animal carcass with blood dripping. So next, we enter into a room that is really, really green.
The sculptures here, large hooded figures, were woven from upcycled textiles and took inspiration from dinosaur fossils.
Next up, there are some Dalek-looking sculptures. So this is done by Barbara Kruger. Her new installation for the Milk of Dreams is an environment comprising text-printed vinyl and a three-channel video component that confronts the viewer with the ironically disembodied voice that is characteristic of her practice. The installation directly addresses the viewer, your fear, your touch, with imploring faces. Please care, please mourn, in both English and Italian, creating an immersive reflection of visibility, insecurity, and grievance. We report the presence of butterflies. Right, we just finished all the individual artists. We're now going to see the country's pavilions now. Right, we are in the Peruvian pavilion now. The work is done by Herbert Rodriguez. It's called Peace is a Corrosive Promise. The work on show in Venice responds to the realities of Peru's new democracy, one born from the ashes of a 12-year junta rule. The title of the exhibition, Peace is a Corrosive Promise, reflects the authoritarianism, terrorism, and unrelenting violence that often define Peru's early attempt at democracy as warring faction battles for power and supremacy. Rodriguez is the sole representative of Peru in his pavilion, and this is one of the first time the artist has been significantly recognized by the established Western art world. But this is not fine art, it's punk. Rodriguez has always remained disinterested in the gallery system. His work is fungible and raw.
The work on show in Venice is printed on cheap, mass-produced paper as it was in Lima in the 1980s. The works are direct to the point of lurid, collages shaped to resemble a penis, filled with photographs taken from porn magazines, cut and shaped to tessellate with documentary image of conflict, or interspersed with headlines reporting political violence taken from newspapers. But the intent is clear. One work repurposes text from an Amnesty International report dating to October 1983, which detailed torture, disappearance, and executions in the Peruvian capital. Rodriguez transformed the dry technical text into a loud graphic animation.
Next, we have the South Africa Pavilion. So here, they have a tablet, and it seems to suggest when I scan for you, you can get augmented reality. Let's try that. You see a boat underneath the picture. It's not there in real life. As I put the pad in front of the painting, you can see there is a globe, which is not on the painting. Next, we have the New Zealand Pavilion, which is called Paradise Camp by Yuki Kihara. With wit and verve, Yuki Kihara reworks the Polynesian paintings of Paul Gauguin to highlight members of Samoa's third gender community, Fa'afafine, including the artist herself. A culturally recognized group in Samoan society for generations, these are people who were assigned male at birth, but who express their gender in a feminine way. When Kihara first saw Gauguin's painting at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York in 2008, she was struck by the resemblance between the semi-nude Tahitian woman Gauguin depicted and her Fa'afafine friends. Some research suggests that Gauguin's models were Mahu, members of Tahiti's third gender. These were the twin inspiration behind Kihara's Paradise Camp project, dissecting the painter's erotic and exotic image of a paradise island and reenacting them as celebratory portraits of Samoan queer culture. This is the Lebanon Pavilion. The title is called The World in the Image of Man. The installations on show in the Lebanese pavilions reflect the never-ending chaos affecting the Middle Eastern country, which has collapsed both economically and politically. Aubrey's split-screen video, Allo Sherry, is stopping visitors to the Arsenale in their tracks. What is this sinister car chase around Beirut? And why is the woman who narrates the piece constantly chasing down money? In the Lebanese pavilion, there is also a two-sided installation that reinforces the idea of a fragmented city. One side is covered in alluring neon lights and spray-painted tarpaulins, while a disconcerting hut filled with detritus sits behind the tawdry facade, illustrate eloquently and forcefully the two faces of Beirut.
This is Ghana's pavilion.
Right, we're finished with most of the pavilions now. We're walking to the Italian pavilion at the far end, but the scenery here at Arsenale is quite pretty too.
The Arsenale area is really a very dramatic area for the Biennale. If you enjoyed this video, please give me a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe to my channel with notifications on. That way, you won't miss another video from me. This is the Italy's pavilion, but looks like there might be a bit of a queue to join the pavilion. There is a very long queue for the Italian pavilion. We asked around, I think it will take at least an hour before we could get in if we join the queue now. So I think we're gonna skip it because we don't really have that much time.
On the opposite side, there is an interesting sculpture with clasping hands. So we're finished with this year's Biennale Art Exhibition. As you may have noticed, this 59th edition will go down in history as the Women's Biennale. Out of the 213 artists represented here, only 21 are male, which is a complete opposite from before. From Algerian-born Zineb Sadira's French film set in the French Pavilion, to Simone Lee's stunning American pavilions, as well as Breakout's the monumental bell-shaped figure, to Barbara Kruger's stunning text installation, it has been a really memorable show full of highlights, and the whole exhibition has been beautifully created. Thanks to Cecilia Alemani, the curator. If you have watched all the way till the end, I thank you. Stay tuned and next time I will show you the rest of the Venice trip.